Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Bill Simons, and I'm the Director of Engineering and Technology at Harvard Catalyst Informatics. I've been working on Shrine through almost all of the history that Doug just went through. I've been on the team for just over 10 years now. Let me start to share my screen, and I will talk about Shrine architecture. Doug touched on a bit of it, and I will try and go into the Goldilocks zone of not too much and not too little here in terms of detail. Are you seeing my presentation view or my presenter view at this point?
You see the presentation view. You're great.
Excellent. Okay. So I will be covering sort of the key concepts and components of the Shrine architecture, including our query entry point, which is really all the user-facing suite of applications and the services that those applications rely on. The adapter, which is the site-specific worker that translates queries into from the global network ontology into the local ontology and communicates with IPv2. I'll be talking about the hub, which is sort of our messaging router. And so sort of the overall concept of how those fit together into the current network topology that we favor. So our query entry point, as I mentioned, is where the user-facing suite of tools are. Most relevant, I think, is the query tool, which you'll see more of a demonstration on later. This is where our users will be able to interact with the ontology, browsing and searching, composing those terms into interesting queries, and viewing the results and managing the results of their historical queries. The query tool communicates with our query entry point service using standard RESTful APIs, JSON over HTTPS. And the query entry point is where all the business logic happens in terms of constructing the data models that will be displayed to the user, managing the user's sessions, and communicating out to the network with the hub. The query entry point relies on a few external services. Notably, we use the IPv2 PM cell for managing users and their authentication and their session. We store all of our results from the network in what we call the forward cache here. It's a database of all of the query definitions that users have defined, the results that we've gotten back for those queries, and the status of the result as well, whether it's an error or incomplete. Sometimes results can be held up at sites either because they have lots of data or that and they've queued the queries, or perhaps the site adapter is not online at the moment and will pick up its query execution at a later time. We also have our Lucene index, actually indices, for the ontology service that we wrote. This service does two things for us, or these indices provide two pieces of functionality for us. The first is auto-suggest, so that when a user wants to filter down the ontology into terms that he or she is interested in, they can begin typing. DIA would auto-suggest perhaps diabetes or diagnosis. And after you've selected that first term and you, let's say diabetes, you might start typing your second term, M, and you'll see now diabetes mellitus. So I will suggest up to 3 serial terms, and that's done according, they're ranked according to the number of times those terms occur in the ontology itself. The second index is used for searching to find the actual terms in the ontology and their location within the ontology so that you can filter the entire ontology down to ontology terms that just have your search terms in them. I'll also briefly mention the Data Steward application here. This is effectively used right now so that a data steward, a person designated at a site as a data steward, can monitor the types of queries that are being run on at their site and make sure everything is above board in terms of what the site has agreed to for their terms of use. Still at the site-specific side, we have the Shrine Adapter. This is the software component that receives messages, receives queries from the network, will translate those queries into local terminology. For example, mail at the global ontology level might be capital M-A-L-E, and locally it could map to several different terms like lowercase m or capital M or all lowercase M-A-L-E or some code that represents that concept as well. And the adapter will, after translating those terms, will run that query with the standard ITB2 run query from query definition request, and interact with the CRC to receive the results or receive a queued status or still processing, in which case the adapter knows it needs to check back later for those results to be ready. The adapter relies on a working database such that in order to store the mapping, the mappings themselves, but also to store the results and extra some metadata used by several plugins that have been written, administrative plugins that have been written, so that sites can see what types of queries are being run, what types of queries have been flagged as important to users. And I think those are the main cases there. And then the hub is what this, so this piece is not actually hosted at your site. This would be hosted centrally. The hub is our messaging router, receiving incoming requests, messages from the QEP, which would look like a query that the hub is supposed to broadcast out to all of the downstream nodes. It will also receive results back from the adapter when those adapters are ready with the results. And then there's some processing and some storage that happens with the results and the queries before they are routed into their outgoing queues, which will send the queries to the adapters and the results to the target QEPs, query entry points. And you can see we have the loving term here of MOM, which stands for message-oriented middleware. This queuing system, by the way, is what really in combination with polling, long polling requests, is what enables the asynchronous behavior that Doug was referring to earlier, whereby sites can return their results and the user can view those results as they're coming in, and we don't have to wait for all of the sites to process the query before you can see the results of some of the sites. All right, and this is the big picture, how each of these components fit together Here you can see what a typical Shrine site would look like. We have the QEP components over on this side and the adapter components at that site as well. Typically, sites act as both a QEP and an adapter, although that's not strictly required depending on the needs of the network. The site communicates with the Shrine hub, which will then route those messages, the outgoing queries, the incoming results to and from other sites. And this one here, we just have as an adapter, maybe the users at this, maybe there are no users at this site. It's just a data provider on the network. And finally, we have the sort of high level view of how each of those components fit together. This is what we refer to as our hub and spoke network topology. You can see all of these sites we refer to as downstream nodes. They're downstream from the hub. An example, if the site that we were seeing earlier might be, for instance, this downstream node, which would communicate out to the hub, not with any of the other sites, and use the hub to send those messages out. In earlier versions of Shrine, we used other types of topologies that were much more difficult to manage administratively and operationally. The notable one being a fully meshed network where instead of having one hub, every site would have a QEP, an adapter, and a hub, and they would all be linked together in this spider web. Again, that was quite difficult to manage, but the reason that we operated in that way at that time was that we wanted to decentralize control of the network. We soon learned that that decentralization to that extent was not necessary and also too challenging. So this is the simplified view that we and the architecture that we recommend now, or rather the topology that we recommend now. And I believe that's it. Yep. And Mark mentioned that we'll do questions at the end. So I will pass the baton back and thank you for your time.
All right. Thank you, Bill. Appreciate it. I think it's really great to run through some of these kind of basic concepts to kind of either enhance your understanding of how Shrine and a network works or to just, sort of improve that understanding. But we should move on then to Anupama.
We do have a question in the Q&A if you want to take a look at it.
Sure.
Or I could read it out loud.
I can write it out loud. And so, Bill, I guess this might be for you. And if it's easier to answer sort of live and now, we could do that. Or if you want to sort of type out an answer. But Michael from Wake Forest is asking if it's possible to have the adapter assume a one-to-one mapping and not require an adapter mappings XML anymore.
We have bounced back and forth on this several times. And right now we're in the state where the one-to-one mapping is required. That could be open for debate and perhaps we could make that configurable such that different networks could have different requirements. The ACT network wanted to have the one-to-one mapping as a requirement. It can be used as a way to restrict the terms that your site will respond to, and we wanted to make sure that we preserved that feature for the sites in the ACT network. But yes, I can understand the desire to have the one-to-one mapping be automatic for networks in which that would be the standard for all sites.
Okay, so adapter mappings.xml still required even in the case of one-to-one mappings, correct?
Yes, although we don't use the XML format anymore. We use a CSV format, and then that actually gets translated into database rows So it can be managed either through the database or through a CSV file.
Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I just wanted to comment that even in the ACT environment where the rules of the road are, we use the exact same ontology for the Shrine app as is all the I2B2 instances, we have found it useful when we're releasing a new version of the ontology to sometimes sites work with their mapping file to prevent sort of error messages coming up that don't make any sense because they haven't adopted the new ontology or something of that sort. So there are some uses for the mapping file, even when you have a strict one-for-one model.